CIA's covert operations since World War II and assesses whether those operations have helped U.S. foreign policy goals. In his new book, Safe for Democracy, Mr. Prados looks into the CIA's involvement in Iran, Guatemala, Chile, Cuba, and other countries. The event was hosted by MIT's Security Studies Program and is an hour and 20 minutes.
I want to welcome everybody. This is our regular Wednesday Security Studies Program speaker series. We're quite happy to have with us today John Prados. I've actually known John since I started out in this business in my early 20s. We were just reminiscing a little bit about a little study group that he used to run in Washington when I was still, in fact, a graduate student. John is based in Washington, D.C., and he has a Ph.D. from Columbia University. He focuses on presidential power, international relations, and intelligence and military affairs. He has a long vita, and I won't read everything, but now he is a senior fellow and project director with the National Security Archive. His current book is Safe for Democracy, The Secret Wars of the CIA, and I think maybe we've had some flyers that we've shown on that. He is the author of 15 other books with titles on national security, intelligence matters, diplomatic history, military affairs, including books on Iraq and Vietnam and World War II. Among these books are Hoodwink, The Documents That Reveal How Bush Sold Us a War. I happen to like a book from some time ago when he was doing a lot of work on Vietnam, Valley of Decision, The Siege of Khe Sanh, which is one of my favorites. He's had chapters in 24 other books and entries in 5 reference works. He's a contributing editor to Military History Quarterly, the Quarterly Journal of Military History. He's had articles and op-eds in Vanity Fair, The Washington Post, The New York Times, The LA Times, The Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists, Scientific American. And he also does a lot of things on the web now at tompaine.com, tnr.com, and American Prospect Online. We're pleased to have him with us, and he's going to be speaking about covert operations in United States foreign policy.
Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be up here. Boston's one of my favorite towns, and I love it every time I get to come back. Cambridge, even more. Really, what I'm talking about today comes off of the book that I just completed, Safe for Democracy, but it's not looking at the past that I want to do today. It's looking at the future. And I want to talk to you about a problem that I think we are going to have. The next covert operation failure, as opposed to the ones in the past. I am worried about this, and I think that you should be too. I think that this is a problem that Americans have not successfully dealt with, and we're in a situation where the importance of the issues and the subject is such that we really need to focus on this before it comes back to bite us. What I'm going to do this afternoon is to lay out a series of considerations that structure this hypothetical problem, and I'm going to explain why it is a problem. I can't tell you where this is going to become the thing that bites us. I can't tell you when it's going to bite us, but I am very fearful. I am very afraid. First of all, I'll lay out in general what we're going to discuss. We're going to talk a bit about CIA capabilities for conducting covert operations, management of covert operations, how that impacts the situation that we are in today, the global environment for covert operations, I'm going to give an example. Now, many people, when they think about CIA failures and failed covert operations, the first thing that springs to their minds is the Bay of Pigs. The Bay of Pigs disaster back in 1961 was so big and so broad that people have called it the perfect failure. This Bay of Pigs was the product of the CIA of a certain era and a certain generation. Today's CIA is a different CIA. The modern CIA, when we were discussing getting into Iraq, a White House advisor on covert operations worried about one particular plan, decided to denigrate it, and to denigrate it he came up with a different little phrase. It was Bay of Goats. This little intervention in Iraq would turn into a Bay of Goats. The covert operations problem is somewhere in between the Bay of Pigs and the Bay of Goats, and this is why. First, on capabilities. The Central Intelligence Agency, as I said, is not the same animal as it was in 1961. The CIA is no longer a full-service covert operations entity. The CIA of the Bay of Pigs era could field its own little navy to move a Cuban brigade to Cuba, field its own little air force to support these guys, create an entire support infrastructure that backed the covert operation, and have people in charge of management and the tactical direction and employment of the forces in the course of this covert operation. The CIA of 2007, although in fact we have been restructuring and recreating capability at the CIA for now almost a decade, does not rise to the level of what existed in 1961. It's a very different kind of standard operating procedure that we use today. In fact, we do more of management and recruiting than we actually do in terms of carrying out operations. The CIA of 2007 functions a lot more, if you want to think about colonial eras and colonial administrations, a lot more in the context of what would be a comprador. That is, we hire local groups and fund local groups, and they do the action. They take care of the action and fight in our behalf, and we are the bankrollers. The Special Activities Division of the Central Intelligence Agency is working hard to recreate capabilities, and in fact we have plentiful capabilities. The United we've recreated a certain structure of proprietary organizations. We have trained more people, and we are reinforcing this element of the CIA, but we are not at the point, and I don't think are going to be there in the conceivable future of, or in the foreseeable future, of being able to conduct a full-service covert operation. That is not to say that the United States lacks these capabilities. The United States military is now the repository of that piece of the American panoply of warfare. The Special Operations Command, the United States Special Operations Command, which is in charge of our military forces in this area, is quite robust. It is already at a strength level of over 50,000. In all, and they are in the current five-year defense budget and program in the course of implementing another 15% increase, which will put them at a strength level of about 65,000 in U.S. Special Operations Forces. Now, just to give you a point of comparison there, a standard U.S. military division ranges from about 15,000 to 18,000 soldiers. And a so-called division slice, which is the division with all of its support forces, in the range of about 25,000. Two divisions plus equals a corps in U.S. military parlance. And what we're looking at is an elite force, a small, quote-unquote, specialized elite force, the Special Operations Command, which actually constitutes the equivalent of a full U.S. Army Corps. So Special Operations Forces are no longer the kind of specialized, concentrated, focused force that they were in the 1960s or 1970s. They are, in fact, a large aspect of U.S. military activity. Not only are they a large aspect of activity that drives other issues, that drives defense programming, that drives defense planning. The so-called global war on terrorism has also resulted in a situation where, in operational terms, those forces are expected to carry out a much wider range of the military activities and military actions that the United States is in fact conducting. Much of the training of local forces in many different countries, a lot of the sort of special warfare kinds of missions that are being carried out, and virtually all of the specialized kinds of search for the terrorist operations that are that have gone on in several countries are all the province of the United States Special Operations Command. Now, beyond that, the Central Intelligence Agency, because it lacks these capabilities that we talked about, has to rely on other actors. One of them is the U.S. Special Operations Command. But more important, or at least equally important, are foreign intelligence agencies. It is, in fact, the case, just as we are working in this sort of a comprador situation, that the United States relies on foreign agencies for an increasing proportion of the covert activities that are carried on by the United States. Some estimates put that figure as high as 90%. Okay. Now let me talk a bit about environment. During the Cold War, Americans may have agreed or disagreed with the bases and premises of the Cold War and with whether the United States and the Soviet Union should be enemies. But there was an impact from the fact that the Cold War was an ongoing conflict. That is to say that Americans did not pay political attention very much to the outcomes and processes of American covert operations. The Cold War basically created a political overlay that prevented a kind of political fallout from the covert operations program that we were carrying out. Now, there were always global political impacts from covert operations. If you went to Guatemala, or you went to Chile, or you went to any of these third world countries where CIA operations had been carried out, and if you consulted global public opinion, there was a certain image of the United States, and that image was affected by American covert operations. Not true in the United States. The end of the Cold War, however, ended that bit of political cover. It ended the overlay that protected covert operations from being scrutinized more deeply, let's just say. Okay. At the same time, however, the global interests and fears about covert operations increased. And it's possible, one could argue, that the Cold War also had an effect in the Third World in that perhaps people understood why American covert operations took place, but were less worried about them than they might have been otherwise. It's also possible to argue that the reason for the increased salience of this factor is because of the kind of societal and ethnic oppositions and conflicts that have arisen since the end of the Cold War. In any case, for whatever reason, American global actions are now in the spotlight and in a critical spotlight to a much greater degree than they were at the time of the Cold War. At the same time that this overlay that protected, if you will, covert operations no longer exists. In addition, of course, our intervention in Iraq and the continuing conduct of the war in Iraq have been so controversial in the world at large that the public opinion benefit we gained from being the victims of the 9/11 attack has been more than wiped out in the course of our operation in Iraq. The net result of this is that the United States' image before the world community is at an all-time low. The annual Pew Foundation surveys of global public opinion in country after country show that opinion of the United States is in the basement. Even in countries that are our traditional allies, pro-U.S. opinion is in the minority and sometimes in a very small minority. This is also a global situation where events of a cultural, social, political kind, the very kinds of events that are the aims and substance of covert operations, covert political actions, are increasingly controversial. This is a world in which the publication of cartoons that poke fun at a religious figure can foment riots in a dozen countries in which people die. It's a world in which the use of an armed, unmanned aerial vehicle, a Predator drone, by United States intelligence forces to shoot at what we believe is a meeting of terrorist leaders can result in violent riots in a country. It's also a world in which our allies, presiding over unstable political situations themselves, are the possessors of capabilities that it would be greatly detrimental to American interests if those capabilities fell into the wrong hands. So there is a countervailing pressures between the tensions inherent in the system and American disposition to act within the situation. All right. Given all of that, I think that there is a danger of action. And action is dangerous for the reasons that I'm going to lay out to you. Okay. First of all, the agency, and not just the agency, but the United States government, the president, the national security system, are demanding action in this war on terrorism situation. That results in what the CIA themselves call a, quote, high tempo of operational activity. They are not only carrying out a high tempo of operational activity, but according to General Michael Hayden, the current director of the CIA, they anticipate an even higher level of operational activity in the near and intermediate futures. All right. This coincides with other activities that are going on within the U.S. intelligence community. That is to say that the wholesale reorganization of U.S. intelligence, which began with the creation of this new office, this so-called Director of Intelligence office, has yet to be resolved. The whole management, monitoring, and control situation within the U.S. intelligence community is in a flux. There was a pre-existing issue between the Central Intelligence Agency and these military special operations forces that I was talking about, plus the Department of Defense itself, about the management and control of intelligence operations between the U.S. military and the CIA. The previous Secretary of Defense, Donald Rumsfeld, was carving out, and in the process of being successful at it, a much larger military sphere of action in what were traditional intelligence agency bailiwicks or provinces. Okay, so that's an existing and persisting management problem. There is another situation that applies directly within the CIA, and that is that the agency is currently engaged in, started last month if they're on schedule, a new reform operation. The new CIA reform operation is specifically intended to provide it the capabilities to meet this higher operational tempo, and it's also intended to transform a whole series of other intelligence capabilities and issues on the analytical side and other things, things that I won't bother you with right now. But in any case, this has two impacts, the first being that high-level CIA managers, the director, General Hayden, his deputy director, Stephen Capps, have a great deal of their time invested in these programmatic and managerial issues and less time available for strict issues of monitoring and control on covert operations. That's one aspect of it. And the other aspect is that in order to maintain and achieve this higher operational tempo, the traditional mechanism that the agency has used to review and deconflict and sort of pass on proposals for covert operations hasn't actually been short-circuited, but has been eroded to a certain degree, so that less management attention is given to whether a given covert operations proposal is a good idea or can be carried out within the context of available situations and forces and so on. For example, we now have a situation where there exists a pre-delegated authority to the Pentagon to carry out what's called intelligence preparation of the battlefield. And under this program, the Pentagon covert operators can spend up to $25 million anytime to prepare one of these so-called battlefields. Since the battlefield, if you like, in the global war on terrorism constitutes the globe, in effect, the Pentagon has pre-delegated authority to carry out a $25 million covert operation anywhere in the world. The Pentagon,
Million.
The Pentagon has also maintained to the congressional oversight committees that its activities do not constitute intelligence operations in their understanding of intelligence operations, and therefore are not subject to committee oversight or to the system that exists under which presidents have to issue so-called findings in order to carry out a covert operation, which are fed through the intelligence committees of the U.S. House and Senate. So the entire oversight situation with regard to military activities in this area is problematical. The intelligence committees of the Congress themselves have a problem today, and that is that there is so much on their plate. Actually, two problems. But the first one, there's so much on their plate, you know, with the switch in party control after the last election and the determination of the Democrats to do, quote-unquote, oversight. And the list of controversial things that has already piled up in which they want to exercise oversight of, the amount of time and attention that's available to be put into these kinds of new activities is limited and is going to, I'm not sure complement is the right word to describe this situation where our span of control is narrowing, but it's going to contribute to this inability to manage and control effectively these U.S. covert operations. All right? The second problem is, if anything, even more alarming, and that is that there's a significant issue as to whether the largest component of U.S. covert operations is under their oversight at all. This actually goes back to the year 1991 and the first Bush administration, when there was a fight between the intelligence committees and President George Herbert Walker Bush over whether so-called third country activities of U.S. intelligence were or were not subject to congressional oversight. Language was put into the 1991 Intelligence Authorization Act, which subjected these activities to oversight from the committees. Although the administration and the committees had negotiated that language in advance of its being put into the bill, and although, as far as the committees understood, this was acceptable to the White House. In fact, the first President Bush pocket vetoed the Intelligence Authorization Act measure at that time. And since 1991, no language has existed in U.S. law that subjects third country intelligence activities to U.S. congressional oversight. That has the effect that if 90% of our operations are in fact utilizing third country sources, that is a problem. Now, if everything was smooth with our third country allies in the intelligence arena, maybe the problem would be less. But there, too, in fact, we're facing an increasingly alarming situation, and because of our own actions. All these things that the Congress wants to exercise management, oversight, and control of, these issues that are left over, things like, and not limited to, the CIA secret prison system and the renditions and the issue of the treatment of detainees, all of those things have a direct impact on our intelligence alliances, the alliance relationships that we're counting on so heavily. And we're not talking just about the general public opinion now in these third countries. We're talking about the direct interests and activities of intelligence officers in those countries. All right? In the in Canada, where we had this problem with the person Maher, who was arrested by the FBI and sent to Syria and whatnot, significantly involving U.S. security services, the head of the Royal Canadian Mounted Police has been forced to resign. There was a parliamentary inquiry into the activity of Canadian intelligence and its alliance with the U.S. In Germany, there is also a parliamentary inquiry going on about German contacts with American intelligence, including but not limited to another one of these rendition cases, the one of the individual named Al-Masri, who was also picked up on American instructions. And then the question of German collaboration with us in the initial phases of the Iraq War. In Italy, the head of the Italian military intelligence service is on trial, and as is his deputy. One of the other senior officers committed suicide, and more than a dozen others are implicated in yet another one of these CIA rendition cases. And, oh, by the way, you know, two dozen CIA officers have been indicted in Italy, and about a dozen more in Germany. In the entire history of American covert operations, until now, there has never been a case when American officers serving in their standard operational roles have actually been the subjects of criminal indictments in foreign countries. And when you look at that situation and you combine that with the fact that foreign intelligence officials acting in their official roles are also being subjected to these kinds of investigative action, that has got to have an impact on the willingness and ability of foreign intelligence services to collaborate with the United States. And again, what we're talking about is the vast majority of U.S. covert operations capability. The net result of all this, I believe, is that there is this high operational tempo, there is a desire to carry on the operations and a drive to carry them out. And I haven't even mentioned the issue of the wide array of targets, that is, the countries where the United States has a security problem or a prospective security problem that might require the use of a CIA covert operation. But let me assure you that that is a long list, and it involves countries on just about every continent. And we can go through the list and discuss a whole bunch of them, but I see I'm running out of time, so I'm going to not do that. But there are a huge number of potential theaters of action that would require these kinds of activities and would bring us into this situation of vulnerability. All right? Then the underlying sort of, or I shouldn't say underlying, the capstone, the overlying, the capstone to this whole management problem is inherent in the system of presidential findings by which U.S. presidents authorize covert operations in the first place. And that is, the finding comes to a president's office as a sort of negotiated document that the CIA has fed through this system of approvals that we referred to earlier. And it basically states the president thinks that doing X thing is important in Y country, and therefore I am authorizing this action. The document that's coming to the president has not got the same degree of attention focused on it as before. The president himself doesn't have the staff or resources to actually vet every one of these covert action proposals in the first place, and various presidents have differing degrees of interest in carrying out or pushing these covert operations, and this president, as you know, has been especially enthusiastic about pushing them, so that there isn't a high degree of managerial control infused at the top level either. And the documents themselves aren't defined closely enough or detailed enough in terms of their content and review of the covert actions, the specifics of the covert actions, that they constitute a useful control. The net result of this, I think, is that there's going to be a problem. Now, you may say, well, this is all hypothetical. You know, who knows if this is going to happen? Well, I will tell you, the reason I am as afraid as I am is that it already has. And let me tell you a story, and it's about a covert operation. Remember Somalia? Remember the dish and Black Hawk Down? In 1998, two American embassies in Africa were bombed. We decided that it was Al-Qaeda that was behind these embassy bombings. We started a major covert effort to get at the bad guys responsible for these operations. In the course of the period after 1998, we executed a whole series of different kinds of covert operations and activities that were designed to bring to justice and or otherwise neutralize the specific people that were involved in the 1998 embassy bombings. All right. Among the activities and actions that we carried out was that we posted rewards for anyone who would turn over one of these bad guys to us or give us the information that would lead to the apprehension of a certain bad guy. Everyone thought, hey, this is a fine idea. It's something Americans could do. It's well within our ability to do it. And there was never any controversy, neither within the authorization system nor within the management system, about putting this structure of reward into place. All right? In Somalia, in April of 2003, one of the Somali warlords apprehended one of these bad guys from the 98 embassy bombings and turned him over to the CIA, where he disappeared into the secret prison system. As soon as he got the reward money, there were lots of other Somali warlords who were very interested in the fact that this guy had all this money. And, you know, crisp new $100 American bills were showing up in the marketplace in Mogadishu and all this kind of stuff. A good show altogether. They wanted some money, too. So there was a whole rush in Somalia on the part of a number of warlords to get on this bandwagon. Before long, there was an alliance, a national security alliance of a number of warlords, and we're not talking about just people out on the street there, we're talking about people that included the national security advisor to the Somali provisional government, some of the most important clans in the country, and others who constituted themselves as an alliance and came to the Americans through channels to say, we will act in your favor, we will help you apprehend these bad guys, and can you give us maintenance money? And we agreed. And so we began to subsidize a number of these Somali warlords to the tune of $100,000, $150,000 a month. The money was delivered in cash by CIA teams who would fly into designated spots in the country to hand over the money to the people we were supporting. Meanwhile, in Somalia, the fundamentalist Islamists, looking at these warlords who were suddenly banding together and who were demonstrating that they had this American money, they began to get fearful themselves, and competition between fundamentalist Islamics and CIA-supported Somali warlords became an issue. All right? In January of 2006, one of these CIA teams flew into an airfield about a dozen miles north of Mogadishu to make its delivery. And unbeknownst to the CIA guys, this particular piece of real estate where this airstrip was located was actually the subject of a real estate dispute between one of our warlord guys and one of these Islamists. And they were fighting over who got to control that territory. And they were fighting at the moment that the CIA team landed at the airstrip. When our people landed at the airstrip and fighting was going on a couple miles away, we interpreted that is the CIA interpreted that, as an attack on a CIA team. These were Islamists trying to attack a CIA team in the field in a U.S. operation. Therefore, we decided they've started a war on us, we better fight back. All of a sudden, what had been a simple transaction about chasing bad guys and bringing them to justice turned into a secret war. Between January and the spring of 2006, the CIA operation in Mogadishu changed from being this kind of nickel and dime thing to being a real covert operation. Porter Goss, who was then the head of the Central Intelligence Agency and who almost never made foreign trips during the course of his tenure at Langley, actually visited Nairobi, the next country over, wherein the station chief was the one who was in charge of this Somali covert operation, to urge on the case officers to do their thing. In the spring of 2006 and into the summer, open warfare then began between the CIA-supported warlords in Somalia and the Islamists, who fought better, had more structure in their forces, and drove back the CIA-supported warlords. By the fall of last year, the Somali provisional government was forced out of its capital, sought refuge in Baidoa in northern Somalia. The United States had a significant foreign policy problem in Somalia that had not existed at all before this little CIA problem. And the solution to that contributed to the problem. What we did was go to the Ethiopians, the next country up the coast, and get the Ethiopians to support the Somali provisionals and warlords who were our clients in this whole situation. Now, Somalia and Ethiopia fought a war, you may or may not know this, a couple decades ago, over a peace of Somalia called the Ogaden. And there's nothing more inimical to a Somali than an Ethiopian, and basically vice versa. So by pulling in the Ethiopians to save our clients in Somalia, we created and then created a situation where we deepened our foreign policy problem in this whole region and area. And the success of the Ethiopians is the measure of how much deeper our problem has become. Yes, there was a short-run success, and the Ethiopians and the Somali warlords counterattacked, regained Mogadishu, and are currently in control there, but and supposedly drove the Islamists back across the Kenyan border, an operation which, by the way, involved the intervention of the U.S. Special Operations Forces, which carried out some gunship attacks and put in a team on the ground looking to verify whether some of the dead people were in fact or were not some of the perpetrators we were seeking from the 98 embassy bombings. But in any case, it resulted in a hairy situation and one that has come back to bite us. The Islamists were initially driven back across the Kenyan border, but they've resuscitated themselves as an insurgency. And in the last 4 months, a third of the population of Mogadishu has fled the city. We're talking 300,000 people to get away from the fighting that's going on around their homes. This is just a minor example, really, of the kinds of dangers that are inherent in the situation as it obtains today and the way that we are managing and controlling our covert operations. And that is why I argue that we have a problem. Now, at this point, I'm going to stop and throw open the floor, and we can talk about any concern that you have. I'm expert on declassified documents and many aspects of U.S. national security history, in addition to any of this intelligence stuff. Ma'am. Oh, okay.
In Somalia, that it deepened problems in the region. I can see a lot of disasters that could happen from covert operations. One is that we could lose American lives, and lots of them. One is that we could lose traditional allies over it. One is that we could shame the U.S. in the eyes of the world. Maybe we'd kill a lot of innocent civilians. I wonder if you could take the fact that it's that a lot of the this work is now being done by special operations forces of the U.S. military instead of by the CIA. And tell us, what bad things do you expect could happen because of that?
That's a very good question. Well, you know, I talked about the CIA as a full-service covert operations entity. And I also said, well, to the degree that we have that capability, that full-service capability, it now resides in the U.S. military. Well, as a matter of fact, the U.S. military has never carried out a full-spectrum covert operation. You know, we've done things like commando raids and sort of, you know, surgical strike-type idea situations, but never going out creating an insurgency or a political movement and moving that from nothing through the overthrow of a government or that kind of thing. I think it's a virtual guarantee that the first time the military tries to carry out one of these things, it goes completely awry and contains inherent in it all of those problems that you mentioned. The killing of foreign nationals, the loss of American lives, the loss of American image abroad, all of those things can be expected to flow from a situation like that.
Bob, let me see if I understand your argument, and then I'll ask my question. I think you said that 90% of covert operations now are being done by Pentagon, whether or not they're full service or not, rather than the CIA. And then you said that I wasn't certain about this, that at $25 million or below, special operations forces have a hunting license to prepare the battlefield. And I assume that would mean gathering intelligence.
It's anything that they say it is. Okay. But let me walk you back here.
Wait.
Okay. It's not 90% that are U.S. military. 90% of covert operations, or up to 90% of covert operations, are being carried out by third countries in the name of the United States.
Okay.
The military is carrying out some proportion of the ones that are actually being carried out by the United States.
Okay, thank you.
But they do have this hunting license that you're talking about.
Okay. So Your argument, I gather, is that there's not sufficient presidential or congressional oversight in order to manage covert operations. Your argument is not against covert operations per se. You're concerned about lots of things happening in which high-level decision makers are not involved. Could you say a little bit more about the chain of command and how these things operate within the Pentagon?
Yeah, absolutely.
To strengthen your argument.
But before I go there, let me say, this is today's subject. This is not, it is not the case that I am not against covert operations. If you look at this book, actually, Safe for Democracy, you will see a rather extensive argument about covert operations themselves and whether or not they are desirable from the standpoint of U.S. foreign policy. And the other thing that this book does, I think for the first time, actually, is it takes covert operations and specifically asks the question, what have covert operations contributed to American foreign policy in the kind of diplomatic history sense of that, right? So it specifically goes to that issue. Now, on your question.
You're portraying an oversight system in which disasters are waiting to happen.
Yes, that's right. That's today's subject. That's right. So on the Pentagon, the Pentagon has a structure in which the United States Special Operations Command, which is a so-called unified command in the sense of the Goldwater-Nichols arrangement, right? Therefore, it has a sink. That sink is responsible for all covert operations proposals that are advanced to the level of the Office of the Secretary of Defense. The Secretary has an undersecretary who's responsible for intelligence activities. Until recently, Steve Cambone. Now it's the former MAP agency chief, Clapper, James Clapper. The vetting of the proposal would be at that level. Cambone, I think, during the time he was there, never met a covert action that he didn't like. Clapper, I expect he will be more cautious and conservative because he is an intelligence specialist and goes way back in the U.S. military. But you're going to have the issue of the desirability of a particular operation, the degree to which the U.S. government is pushing to get it out. So there's a bureaucratic issue there that we can't speak to. And then at the level above him, at the secretary, Gates has a different attitude than Rumsfeld, and one that is more along the lines of giving covert action back to the CIA. So you might find some resistance there, but I doubt you're going to see much resistance at the White House level. So the new specifics cut in a slightly different way, but the propensities in the system continue to be the same.
Barbara Bodine.
You actually started to answer my question, but I'll ask it anyway. First of all, I do agree that covert operations tend to not be as beneficial as their proponents would like you to think, and that the potential for a five-star disaster is just sitting there waiting to happen. But I'd like to continue with the point that you just started, which is the reversibility of this, that even though it may have started, as you were talking about, in 91, that it has accelerated under this administration, under Rumsfeld, and an administration that, as you just said, has never seen a covert operation it didn't like, and has pretty much across the board militarized our foreign policy, just top to bottom. This is just one particularly frightening element of it. Could you talk about the possibility and ways that this structure can be reversed? You've already mentioned Gates. The departure of Rumsfeld and the departure of Cambone, I think, are very important. The departure of Porter Goss, also, who is kind of an enabler, is also terribly useful. And, of course, there's one other key player that also has to be replaced to really get this thing changed. And his faithful sidekick. But could you talk about, with a new Congress, we are going to have a new administration of some description, is there enough recognition within Washington with these new players that some of the more egregious elements of this lack of oversight, of this hunting license, can be, maybe will be reversed before something like this truly blows up in our face?
Reversibility is a key issue in this entire situation. And that really is the reason why I'm out here giving this talk, and I've discussed these matters with other audiences as well. No one, I think, appreciates the situation here or the dangers that are inherent in it. And reversibility, the reversibility of this is a limited quantity, not an extensive one. There is not a lot of energy, if you will. There's not a lot of energy available in the oversight system to bring to bear on this. Well, not just right now, but you've got to understand that the congressional committees are inherently limited. They have small staffs. They have, and the staffs that they have are drawn to particular members in particular ways. So there are physical limits to what they can handle, and their plates. Yes, right now they have all these other sort of pending oversight issues, but in the intermediate and further futures, they're still going to have the daily parade of new oversight items that come up onto the table and have to be dealt with. The budget, every budget cycle, the training issues, the manpower issues. You know, these bread and butter issues are enough by themselves to occupy much, if not most, of their oversight capacity, if you want to look at it as a quantity, right? So there is an issue there. Reversibility at the Department of Defense, yes, it's an advantage to have Gates and these other experienced people, and perhaps they will send things back to the CIA. But as you know, bureaucratic theorists, these kinds of changes tend to acquire a certain momentum, and reversing them is extremely difficult, short of a crisis or a disaster. You know, when there is one of these huge failures and blood is on the ground and embarrassment is stalking the halls, then you may see a rush to change. The key issue really is to prevent that from ever happening by making changes before it becomes a problem. Now, Gates is facing a situation where the Rumsfeld changes already have acquired a considerable momentum, and Gates is sitting in a chair where controlling those things does offer him certain advantages. So it's not clear, even though his predisposition may have been to hand these functions back to the CIA, it's not clear to me that he will actually move ahead and do that. For example, were he to do so, I would have expected action to have started already. But I have heard nothing about some of these little team operations and some of these other little activities that Rumsfeld had appropriated to the Pentagon about their being reversed. And even if he were to move forward on this, he has only a finite amount of time left to him, even if he serves throughout the remainder of this administration. So I think we still have a problem.
Rough deal, Constantine.
I have a question. Over the years, there's been a certain, and I guess varying degree of tension between the CIA and the military intelligence organizations, mainly due to the difference in focus. The CIA is more focused on the political and social, economic, the big pictures of developments, and the military intelligence agencies are naturally more focused on the day-to-day conduct of war. And I was wondering how, over the past 2 years since General Hayden has been in charge of the CIA, how has that tension changed, if at all? And How has having a military officer in charge of the CIA changed or affected the CIA's mission to provide intelligence and warning to the civilian leadership?
Okay, that's a good question. You may or may not know this, but it's actually been almost a tradition at the agency now for several decades that you know, top people were military. You know, if there was a civilian director of Central Intelligence, there was a military deputy. If you go back over the people who have held these jobs, you will see that the pattern that I'm talking about exists. In the early 1990s, a shift actually began toward military personnel at high levels of the CIA, to the degree not just of deputy and director, but the chiefs of various of the top operating divisions as well. However, there's never been a time, I think, where the preponderance of military personnel in senior levels at the CIA has been as great as it is today. Now, what that says about CIA's ability to exercise traditional warning functions or analytic functions, I'm not sure it says very much. I think that the CIA analysis has been affected much more by the number of available analysts and the volume of information available to them than it has been by the particular people at the top of the management pyramid. Now, there's an issue with middle-level management, and that is with the editing on reports. And that process by which a report is structured and produced at the CIA has always been affected by this, because it's really an Achilles heel of the system, that managers are more concerned about how their organizations look, analysts are more concerned about what the report says about the issues, and those two things come together. The military personnel that have come to the CIA have not, by and large, dominated these middle managerial levels of the editors of the reports. So I don't think it's affected the reporting function as much as it will have affected the operational functions of the CIA.
I don't know your name.
You mentioned when the team there was a battle going on. Why do you think there was that failure to know what was going on?
I believe that they saw they were making a routine delivery.
They didn't have any intelligence resources on the ground to tell them.
That's right. The intelligence resources were our warlord friends. They were the intelligence resources.
Jacqueline?
I don't disagree at all with what you said about the operational part of CIA. My only connection with the agency was in the analytical part, which you mentioned. And I would say, although your comments, you know, would suggest that we should all be critical and be wary of the CIA, the analytical part, at least the old days, was something much to be admired when you compare the analytical part to what would have been the case had we depended totally on the military or the AEC or the State Department. And the CIA was the only agency that brought some reason and rationality and balance to the final output that came out. I'm talking about 30 years ago and 40 years ago.
Absolutely.
So it's a comment.
Absolutely. I totally agree with you. I've been an admirer of CIA analysis for a very long time. I wrote a book, in fact, about the CIA and the Russians that basically made the point that CIA analytical capabilities applied to Soviet nuclear programs made the difference between the United States.
Especially when you think about what the output was of the military intelligence and the AEC intelligence and the State Department intelligence, which are all off the wall.
Well, I take a more favorable view of State Department intelligence.
Well, I can tell you a lot about that.
Okay, I would love to have that conversation. Absolutely.
Ben Friedman?
Is it your argument in the book that the problem with covert operations is that they're covert, that there's something inherent about doing things secretly without the democratic process applying to them that tends to make them screwed up and ill thought out?
No, actually. I address covert operations on a number of levels in the book, and I take them on directly. I talk about how there are direct negatives from the way covert operations are structured, from the way they're carried out, that already play against not only the success of them, but their ability to contribute positively to American foreign and national security policies. And I will say something else, too, and that is, it's no longer the case that covert operations are so covert. We now have the overt covert operation, courtesy of the Reagan administration, where for the first time, advocates, proponents of operations and opponents of operations would go out and hire public relations firms to lobby in favor of budgets for the covert operation. You know, before Savimbi in Angola and the Contras in Nicaragua, there never was a covert operation where people pushed politically to obtain budget monies for a covert operation. But now that has happened more than once. So it's not even anymore that covert operations are really covert. Now the universe of covert operations ranges from ones that are truly secret to ones that are sort of in between to ones that everybody actually knows about and argues about every day.
Joseph Regner. Just as a follow-up to the question about your example of how things have already gone wrong, I'm just wondering if you could explain how you go from a few fellas landing on an airstrip in a conflicted region of the country to a conclusion that, you know, the U.S. should ramp up for like a low-intensity conflict, essentially. That seems to be, you know, you make an observation, then you go to a conclusion that seems to be many generation of synapses down the pike. How does that?
It wasn't anything that I did or I thought about. This was the command structure that was carrying out this activity. They had some of their guys attacked on the ground. They assumed that the reason that this, well, they didn't have them attacked on the ground, actually. They were in the presence of conflict. They assumed that the conflict that was going on was directed at them and that therefore there was a move against the United States afoot at this country. They went up their chain of command and whatever authorities that they needed to proceed to expand this operation were given to them. The director came out to the local theater of action to encourage greater activity. Now, I cannot tell you exactly what the thinking was and what the process was by which they went from A to C, but it happened.
So you're saying you really don't know what was in that
black
box?
As a hypothetical, I could tell you how that process works, but I cannot give you the specific, you know, on January 13th, the attack happened. On January 17th, the cable went to headquarters. Those details I do not yet have. As soon as I do, though, you'll hear about it.
You alluded to the good old days, as it would be, in which a full-service CIA had its own Air Force and Army. And there's an implication that there was a sort of a skill level difference, and that makes a fundamental difference in what's going on. When I think about the more famous CIA operations, I don't see that. And in anything that you've mentioned, I guess if I see common threads, it's a willingness to execute what you see are inadvisable applications of force. And the only difference between then and now is a lack of stovepiping between the interagency, which is something most people are happy about. So I don't understand why the military makes
much
of a difference.
This argument has anything to do with stovepiping.
But I don't understand why the military makes a fundamental difference in your argument. I don't see the CIA performance
before. I'm not saying that the military... Wait, don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying that the military is fundamentally involved in this argument. I'm saying that the propensities for covert operations are such, the theaters in which operations might be demanded are such, and the capabilities for management are so small that a disaster is foreseeable. That's what I'm saying. Now, if you want me to discuss the specific issue of military, also, I was not saying that there was a difference in outlook between military and this full-service CIA in years way back when. There was certainly a difference in capability. And the difference in capability persists to this day, although the disparity is now reversed, wherein the military now has the full service capability and the CIA the very limited one, rather than the situation that obtained in the early 1960s.
As I understand the question and your point, the issue is not specifically that the military is doing it. The issue is that the military has been endowed with these capabilities by virtue of SOCOM and been given a kind of a hunting license to prepare the ground in a number of countries, and we've heard about this before, and that therefore, and that the structure of supervision is poor, and as a consequence of that, there are just multiple different ways for you to get yourself into trouble. If you had the same set of capabilities inside CIA operations, given your description of the structure of supervision, you would still have some trouble.
That's right.
Right? But it might be a little bit less because it's not interagency.
Oh, don't overemphasize the military aspect of this problem. This is a general covert operations problem. Whether or not the military has the lead in terms of capabilities, or the military has, or the military and CIA are sharing, for that matter. Is a minor element in this. The real problem is the problem. Here, let's go to unmanned aerial vehicles. Predator, armed with Hellfire missile, okay? This is a specific capability that the military and the CIA fought over tooth and nail in very much the classic bureaucratic politics mode, where the Air Force argued that it was impossible to create an armed Predator UAV because of budget and time constraints and blah, blah, blah. And Clinton White House went to the CIA and said, hey, we need this capability, you know, and can you throw it together? And in a matter of months, the CIA threw it together, and then the Air Force said, well, no, that didn't go through channels. And there was a whole fight about putting the Predator into operation as a weapons platform. And as soon as Mohammed Atef was killed by a Hellfire missile in Afghanistan, and then there was an incident in the Yemen where a bunch of other bad guys in a convoy were blown up by one of these things, all of a sudden the military and the CIA were at each other's throats over who would control the operational capability of the Predator, armed Predator forces. And the current defense budget for the Air Force contains a line item for the deployment of 15 Predator squadrons just as quickly as they can produce the aircraft. The CIA doesn't have equivalent capability in terms of arming 15 squadrons of Predators. But I maintain to you that for the people in a village in Pakistan whose next-door neighbors are blown up by one of these Hellfire missiles, whether it was launched by a CIA team monitoring their Predator or a U.S. Air Force team running the Predator, is going to be of no importance whatsoever. It's going to be Americans acting against our society. And from the standpoint of the overall issue, that is to say, the moral problems involved in the use of these kinds of high-technology remote intervention capabilities, where the actual application of intelligence is even thinner. You know, there is no judge and jury here. There isn't some process by which you determine that Barry really is the bad guy and is guilty of sin, therefore we should blow him up. Right? It's like, you know, well, I think he's Mohammed Atef, so let's blow him up. Those kinds of issues put the United States in a very delicate moral situation in using these capabilities. And yet, we're relying more and more on the high technology stuff because that's what we can do easily. Anyway, it's not just military versus civilian.
I guess I'll let you choose from some questions.
Why don't you just pick one?
Oh, okay.
All
right. I was just in Kenya, and I saw a fair number of refugees. I saw some major Hearts and Minds infrastructure projects in the islands there, digging channels into whatever, silted up villages in the mangroves. A kid asked me, where's my helicopter? Because the only Americans he saw were either there to get somebody or else to build a corral and vaccinate cattle. It seems like the Hearts and Minds stuff, it's a lot easier to make people like you by being nice to them and probably a better use of our money. I like Barry's line, people would rather be friends with a distant sea power than a local land power, and we've definitely got that on our side instead of using a big stick 4,000 miles away trying to kill one guy with it. Say more. I mean, there's a book, Calculating Credibility, right? It says that our whole huge chunks of our foreign policy was based on a wrong idea. The idea of credibility, that once you say you're going to do something, you have to do it. Turns out nobody looks at what you said you were going to do. They only look whether you have the capability and the interest. So what sick idea, what wrong idea? Is there a grand, what's in those people's heads who are spending all of this money to do something that can't possibly bring about good results? I mean, they could spend money, say they could send armies of civilians, say.
Yeah. You're trying to answer the question.
Go for it.
Why don't we let him answer your question?
Well, that is the $64 question. There's no question, you know. Is it we're going to have global democracy? Is it we're going to win this clash of the century? Is it? We're threatened and we're going to get back at them? Is it simple revenge? Is it some complex calculation of, what my father represented in terms of the world and what I can do that's different? And how did I get into this mess and how do I get out of it? I don't know what's in the minds of these people, but I do know that they have the capability for great harm.
Peter Krause.
I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the case of Afghanistan, because from a lot of accounts, CIA and the Special Forces had a large degree of command and control of that battlefield. And my reading of a lot of the mistakes of that campaign at Tora Bora and Kabul and some of these other areas is actually that the guys on the ground seemed to have the right answers, and that actually the people who were doing the oversight were the ones who were making the mistakes in terms of not understanding the situation on the ground and what was needed to go after large concentrations of al-Qaeda, bin Laden, etc. So I wonder if you could talk about that a little bit in the context of your critique.
I agree that the CIA and military cooperated very closely in the Afghan campaign. I think that the guys on the ground did have a good handle on what the overall situation was and what needed to be done. I think they also had a sense of the limitations in the situation, in the sense that they could see that they weren't going to be able to get the Afghans to fight in a certain way, and that was the reason for the recommendation to put in U.S. troops to block at Tora Bora in a blocking position. And yes, it's palpably true that the chain of command which shot down that recommendation was the place to locate responsibility for the failure to get bin Laden at Tora Bora. However, again, there are limitations in the limitations in the mindset, let me put it that way. You know, right in the middle of the Afghan campaign, I was up here on a different trip and I spoke at Tufts, and I was on a panel with a colonel from the 4th Civil Affairs Group that was at the center of the Afghan campaign, and another special forces officer who was in the same group with the ones that we sent in with the teams to help control the Afghan tribal groups. And both of them were pleased as punch and absolutely certain that they had the entire thing under control. And my whole analysis coming from the outside was, you know, this is a hide-and-seek game, and you're not going to catch the guy. And mark my words, you know, 6 months from now, we'll be in this situation and stuck. Now, they were convinced that the Afghan war would be over and we would be out of there, and bin Laden would be gone. So it's not just a question of being on the ground and having a close idea of what you're doing and understanding the issues, because you can do that and you can be confident of your situation. You can still go wrong. So although I would locate responsibility for the failure in the U.S. chain of command, I do still think that there are inherent problems with the technique.
Well, I think we've come to the end of the list of questions, and I think we've come to the end of our appointed time, and all that remains is to thank John for a very stimulating talk.
Thank you very much.
John Prados is a senior fellow at the National Security Archive, located at George Washington University in Washington, D.C. For more information, visit gwu.edu.